Ceremony, so y'all be sure to come early. Anybody that wants to work in Vacation Bible School, there's a sign-up sheet, employer for that, for that, so we'll need teachers, helpers, pop crews, hospitality, and more. So please be in prayer about all that, and we'll have a planning meeting coming up pretty good, pretty soon. Also, we have, besides today, today, tonight, we're going to car practice, yeah, car practice at 4:45, and then our discipleship training at 6 p.m. tonight. In our prayer request, we have Dan Bailey, and Nita Dome, Glenn, and Sandra, and John and Linda Shipp. And they're all, John is recovering good, and so is Glenn and Sandra. And actually, Dan is doing good as well. And Edna's home, she had to get her pacemaker tweaked, and so she's home. And also, Jesse and Eileen are still recovering. Well, actually, Jesse's recovering. She's just playing it safe and staying inside. Joe, she's remembered to keep her in prayers as well as the upcoming Bible study. Also, I want to announce we have Roger Vaughn is visiting with us today, and his fiance, Desiree?
Cassie.
Cassie are going to be married on Saturday. From the ceremony will be from, you know, you ever talk about, it's going to start at 2 o'clock, and then we'll have the reception and all that as well. So anyone wanting to help with the reception, you know, getting that set up and going, that would be appreciated as well. Are there any other announcements?
Y'all, if you have an attending choir and you want to, but you think you can sing or own it, there's no age limit on Ask Gentry. She's one of our key players, and she's a little one. Y'all come to choir at 4:45. I mean, we have a good time, and we worship, you know, praise the Lord. So we practice for the future. If y'all want to come, we'd love to have you.
Okay. And then finally, let's continue to lift up our government and all the decisions that they can make. And with COVID and all of that, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, and what that has accomplished in so many lives and what that will accomplish in so many more. Lord, I pray that you would be with us now as we continue to worship you and praise that you would inhabit the praise of our lips. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to receive our worship as we move forward with lifting our voices to you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 This is a song about times that we're going through right now, and it's, you know, thinking, like you mentioned earlier, we remember to pray for our government, our country, and everyone really in America, not alone. We're going through so much troubles and so much heartaches in this world right now that we as a church can see it, but they're not in the real world. They just really can't see it. And they don't know the peace that we can have. We're just looking to God to get us through these times, because it's with Him and Him alone that we have something to hold on to. And we need to remember that it's always God that we can hold on to, and He'll be an anchor for us. Just call the anchor holds.
Aaron is spot on when he talks about the things that we face in our world today. In America, we have this idea of what we call the American dream. And it's in that American dream that we aspire to achieve, the things that we hope to get out of life, the pursuit of happiness. And have life and liberty. The harshness of life shows us that our dreams rarely come true. There was a young man who pursued his childhood dream of becoming a firefighter. He had initially pursued it through college and paramedic school, but he had realized that that path was not the path to him. And so not to be deterred, he joined the military in order to become a firefighter. As he completed basic training, he reached out to his childhood sweetheart, and the two of them got married, and then they would start their adventure as a married couple, going first to the firefighting school, the military firefighting school. In that situation, he excelled. He and there were a buddy of his, and they were the guys that were in the midst of the fire, and they just enjoyed being firefighters, all that. And again, this young couple, they loved their life. And everything was going great. He got his first duty station, and there he would have to complete 6 months of on-the-job training before finally being qualified or certified as a full-fledged firefighter in the military. It was during that 6 months that schedule they had, they had a 24 on, 24 off, with an additional day off every 2 weeks. It was during that time that a medical condition manifested itself in his life, which disqualified him from being a firefighter and in turn from being in the military. Now there's this couple, directionless in life, and not knowing what to do, and facing the reality, the harsh reality of their dreams dying. We could see this story and recount that with many, many other people. And it's in these times that we have to find peace. We have to find and secure peace. And how is it we do that? Well, Psalm 107 is a song that shows us how to secure God's peace in the middle of life's major disappointments. So turn with me, if you would, to Psalm 107. It's a lengthy reading, and I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of reading God's Word. So Psalm 107, and let's read. It says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy, and gathered out of the lands from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. They wandered in the wildernesses in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. And he led them forth by the right way, that they might go to the city for a dwelling place. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. Those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, bound in affliction and irons, because they rebelled against the word of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. Therefore he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down, and there was none to help. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He brought them out of the darkness and the shadow of death, and broke their chains in pieces. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he has broken the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron in two. Fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, were afflicted. Their soul abhorred all manner of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them sacrifice the sacrifices of thanksgiving and declare his works with rejoicing. Those who go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters, they see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep. For he commands and raises the stormy wind, which lifts up the waves of the sea. They mount up to the heavens, they go down again to the depths. Their soul melts because of the trouble. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man, and are at their wit's end. Then they cry out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distresses. He calms the storm so that its waves are still. Then they are glad because they are quiet. So he guides them to their desired haven. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt him also in the assembly of the people and praise him in the company of the elders. He turns rivers into a wilderness and the water springs into dry ground, a fruitful land into barrenness for the wickedness of those who dwell in it. He turns a wilderness into pools of water and dry land into water springs. There he makes the hungry to dwell, that they may establish a city for a dwelling place, and sow fields and plant vineyards, that they may yield a fruitful harvest. He also blesses them, and they multiply greatly, and he does not let their cattle decrease. When they are diminished and brought low through oppression, affliction, and sorrow, he pours contempt on princes and causes them to wander in the wilderness where there is no way. Yet he sets the poor on high, far from affliction, and makes their families like a flock. The righteous see it and rejoice, and all iniquity stops its mouth. Whoever is wise will observe these things, and they will understand the loving kindness of the Lord. Let us pray. Today, Lord, we ask that you give us wisdom in our everyday living, so that when the challenges of life come our way, we can have the faith to turn and cry out to you for our deliverance. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Psalm 107 kind of starts out with the idea of the redeemed of Israel, which is a reflection of those that God had brought out of the land of Egypt, out of bondage from Egypt. But then it also turns in, after the first three verses, into the following five verses, into those who are the exiles in Babylon. The children of Israel, because of their sin, have been defeated and taken into captivity. As a matter of fact, the northern tribes have become the dispersia, as it's called. They have been dispersed in all the other nations. They have become mixed in with all the other nations. But the nation of Judah, the southern two tribes, had remained. And these are the ones that the Babylonians had come and captured and took into exile into Babylon. And then later on, when Persia took over, and if we want a modern day reference, Iraq had defeated them, and then Iran had defeated Iraq, and the Iranians became the reigning empire over them. And this is where God blessed them in their return, and because he has said, for 70 years you'll go into exile, and after 70 years you'll return. But that return was something less than what they encountered coming out of Egypt. You see, we face disappointment, and I want to say this, that yes, Israel's problems were tied to their sins, but not all of our problems in life are tied directly to sins in our life. Many are, and we don't want to take away from that. But there are those things where the Bible talks about the trials that happen into our life, that happen in our lives, because God is working his plan in our lives. And as it says, that we are to count it all joy when we face these things, but a lot of times that's really difficult. And we face disappointment when open doors lead to desert places. You see, Ezra had been allowed to take some of the people back to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem because of the Persian emperor's heart that he began to have for the people of Israel. And if you go in and look and you want to see the overlapping, this is when Esther, the book of Esther, and as the queen, she is pleading for her nation and for her people. And this is the time when they are returning to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. And yes, there was a level of excitement, but there was also a level of great disappointment. Out of the land of Egypt, we see that there had been, when Moses counted the fighting men, there were over 600,000 fighting men, which means there were approximately 2 million people that came and were brought out of Egypt and into the land of Israel. But with Ezra, there was 50,000. That's a huge decrease in the number of people that were returning to the land that God had promised them. And so the failure of the people, the diminishment in size was somewhat of a disappointment, and they returned to begin to work on the temple. And on the way back, there was the group that went in there, but there was this opportunity for them to travel from the kingdom in Persia into Israel, and people would get lost and find themselves lost into these desert places. You see, it's in the desert places that oftentimes God is going to do his most teaching in our lives. If you remember, Moses was 40 years old when he struck out on his own to try to be the leader of Israel and ended up on the backside of the desert. Moses was there 40 years, and God was molding and shaping him into the man that he wanted him to be before he brought him back as an 80-year-old man into Egypt to lead the Israelites out of bondage and in the wilderness for another 40 years. Moses went from being a criminal and a man on the run to being a leader. And one of the ones that God says is the servant of the Lord. Causing that, that was a title in the scriptures that was very, it had a lot of meaning behind it. Paul, on the road to Damascus, met Jesus and was blinded, and then his eyes would heal, and he went into the desert, into Arabia for 3 years, where he was taught by Christ himself. And it would be 3 years before Paul would ever go to Jerusalem, and then over a decade before Paul would strike out on his first missionary journey. You see, it was that time that God was developing Paul in those desert places, in those places where it seemed like he had no purpose. And we see this and we begin to realize that God uses those desert places for our development and for our preparation to do what he wants us to do. When Jesus came into the synagogue, he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to lead the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." The next thing that they encountered was they faced disappointment because they found themselves as prisoners. You see, sometimes in life, we end up in situations where we feel like prisoners. Now, there are people who are literally prisoners. There are people who are literally in captivities, and there are believers if we go and look in the Babylonians, the children of Israel they were taken in and they were held against their will. They couldn't go about freely. They served, and yes, people rose to prominence, but they couldn't just take off anytime they wanted to. They had to answer to the king. In order to leave the nation, they had to get permission, and that permission under Nebuchadnezzar was not very easy. If you remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or the story of Daniel, there are many things that happened under Nebuchadnezzar, and then under Cyrus, the king of Persia, we see that a lot of that began to soften, but still there were things that where those people felt like they were either literally prisoners or they were so restricted that they felt like they were in prison. You know, a person can be in a bad relationship and be and feel like they're in prison. You can be suffering with loneliness and feel like you're in prison. You can struggle with many things in life. Maybe it's a dead-end job, or maybe it's a job where you're the only believer and you're amongst a bunch of other believers, and you feel like you're a prisoner in that situation. You see, again, it's those that when they came to that point and they realized that they were helpless and hopeless, that they cried out to the Lord. They turned to God. Their life had been a life of running from the nation had been a nation of running from God, and the people ran from God, and then when they got in trouble, they realized instead of running from God, they needed to run to God. And Jesus says, I come to preach so that the captives can be set free. We talked about this in as we discussed the Lord's Supper. You know, that replacement of the Passover, that celebration that the Jews went through of the deliverance of the bondage of the children of Israel out of Egypt. And we celebrate the Lord's Supper as a celebration of the deliverance of bondage from sin in the believer's life. The Bible teaches us in Romans that the dominion of death is broken and we are set free. We face disappointment when our rebellion leads to disillusionment. You know, there were those who suffered medical conditions. They suffered all sorts of afflictions. We even read in Jesus' time that as he was going on, that there were people who were struggling with all kinds of medical conditions. Every place, the Bible teaches us that every place Jesus went, he healed everyone that was there. And it wasn't just to heal people for the sake of healing them, it was to reveal the power that he had, that he was indeed the Son of God, but he healed the people. Oftentimes our sin, right, when we hold on to that sin, man, when we grab it, we're kissing and loving on it and all of that, it's killing us the whole time. And it's our sin, right, it's our sin that brings what? Sin doesn't bring life. Sin doesn't bring eternal life or heaven. Sin brings death and hell. It is the struggles in life. It is the pain and agony. It's the loss of loved ones. It's the struggle with afflictions and addictions in life that sin brings. You want to know about the struggles? I mean, just imagine, and again, I'm not, you know, I'm in a situation where I'm retired from a government job, so at this time, I have a government pension. Lord willing, that continues until the day I die. But if I'd have been a 20-year-old living in this time, I'd have probably been living from paycheck to paycheck, and I'd have probably been climbing the walls with the shutdowns and stuff like that, just struggling with what do I do? How do I care for my family? How do I provide a home? How do I do my job when everybody's telling me and holding me back from being able to do it? When a disease is got us so terrified that we can't take a step forward. How do I do that? You see, this is where 2 Chronicles 7:14 comes in. Mm-hmm. And it's not talking to the lost people. It's not talking to a political party. It's not talking to the Republicans or the Democrats. It's talking to the church. And it's to his people when God says, when my people, right, my people who are called what? By my name, In Acts, we find they were first called Christians. Why? Because they were followers of Christ. When my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways and call me, then what? He will heal the land. Folks, there's some humbling, some praying, and some turning that's still lacking. You see, sin can bring and usher in disillusionment, but oftentimes life can do that on its own. Maybe your dreams were starting out one way and something happened along the way and you got derailed in your dreams. And that those dreams could be relationships, those dreams could be careers, those dreams could be children, those dreams could be anything. Maybe you got derailed in life. And what did they do? Instead of continuing to run from God, they turned and they cried to God. And what did he do? Does it say he ignored them? Folks, we need to look at what those verses said. It says he heard them and delivered them from what? Their distresses. All the things that were distressing them, he delivered them from. And we face disappointment when it seems, when we feel like we're going nowhere. Man, those merchants on the ship, this was one of those things where it's talking about people on a ship and a storm hits and these ships are being taken way high and going way low in the waves. These waves are monstrous waves. And the sailors out there, they can't get their footing because it's being tossed every which way. And they don't even know where they are because the ship is being turned in every different direction. So that they're at sea and they're lost at sea. And they're fearful for their lives. They're wondering. And they don't have a clue where they're going. Chuck Colson, do y'all remember Chuck Colson? He used to work for Richard Nixon. He was one of those guys, if you work with people, you know, you had those managers sometimes have their guys that are their pit bulldogs, or, you know, as they're called, or their hatchet men. Chuck Colson was Richard Nixon's hatchet man. He didn't care what he had to do. He didn't care who he had to go to. He was going to get the job done. And he did that. And then in the Watergate incident, he ended up, after all of that, being indicted for obstruction of justice. And he ended up in a prison cell. Now here this government official is, one of the president's right-hand men, and he's ending up in a prison cell. In prison, Chuck Colson cries out to the Lord. Instead of running from God, Chuck Colson turns to God, and he cries out to him, and he's saved. And Chuck Colson, after 7 years, is delivered from prison and becomes the head, or he implements Prison Fellowship Ministries, which is a successful ministry, ministering to prisoners. And in his books and in his writings, if you've ever read any of his material, he is great. He's done an awesome job. And he has turned from being a pet bulldog to being an ambassador for Christ. You know, sometimes God does that, right? He shifts our dream. He says, this is what you want, and this is where you're going. And we oftentimes don't realize that. God's love is never going to disappoint us. Verse 43, I want us to look in verse 43 and look at those first three words in that verse. It says, whoever is wise. And what is it saying? Whoever is wise, basically, whoever is wise, read the words of this psalm and learn the lesson. God teaches us how to reach out to Him. He teaches us what to do in His Word, and by paying attention to God's response to those that are disappointment, we can learn how to face disappointment ourselves. During his time on earth, Jesus was always inviting people to become his followers. He said to the fishermen by the Sea of Galilee, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. He asked men, and he called people to follow him on a regular basis, and he seeks to do that with us today. He tells to those who are burdened with us with the struggles in life, he says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Perhaps today is the day that you need to stop running from God, and you need to turn and cry out to God, Lord, save me. As Serena comes forward, we're going to have a time of invitation. And just imagine during this time, if Jesus was standing right up here up front saying, I invite you to come follow me, what would you need to do? You see, what the Bible teaches is that's exactly what happens. It's in the person of the Holy Spirit that invites us to come and follow Christ, to turn from chasing after things that are away from God and to turn to God by placing our faith in Christ Jesus. So as we stand, we're going to have a prayer. And if you are a person who needs Christ in your life, if you need prayer, whatever the Holy Spirit is guiding you to do, I invite you to come, because that's what Jesus says. Come. Come unto me, all ye who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let us pray. Father, I pray that you be with us now. Pray that your Holy Spirit would move amongst us, and Lord, for all those who need to come, that they would come. And it's in Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Thank you. a song out, and he's talking about, you know, getting his life right and all of that, so he can maybe one day, he's talking about that King James Bible that's sitting in there, and he's hoping that one day he could get his life to the point where he could go and meet God. I remember when I struggled with that. And man, the words to this song right here, "Just as I am." God takes us and all of our sin and all of our guilt and all of our imperfections. And he says, "Follow me." As we continue in this invitation, I challenge you to follow Jesus.
So it's a beautiful day on this holy day that we have today. And we're so